Thank you, Ian Ramsey. Thank you, Mr. Jackson, Mr. Batchelder. Thank you for having me here. I'm honored to be here. I really like Maine. We went to First Friday the other day. Ian Ramsey took me down to Portland, saw lots of the arts and listened to the music. And I've been spending time at the school, getting to know more of the kids. I know three of the graduates from last summer, Josh, Lena, and Anna. There were six altogether. The others, I believe, have gone on to college. And then Chris will be a senior next year. And I played music with some of these kids the other day. And they put an electric guitar in my lap. And it was like holding a weasel. And it was just, hang on. And Parker Elkins, I don't know if he's here, he just took off on the guitar. And then there was Jack on the bass and Michael on the drums and Noah on the guitar. And it was the Calgary Stampede. It was the biggest rodeo in town, and I just held on. And it was fun. I spend a lot of time, my wife is a supervisory ranger naturalist at Glacier Bay National Park in Alaska. So she hires new ranger naturalists with the National Park Service. And they are roughly between 25 and 35 years of age. It's really nice to have this kind of energy blow into my soul. I like that a lot. I understand why you all do what you do. It's the future. And Ian also served me up hard shell lobster. Next time, I'm going to get a power drill and a skill saw, maybe a chainsaw. What preys on those things? Why do they need such a hard shell? Like, do front end loaders go in the water and try to... Unbelievable. But it was so good, dipped in butter. So, yes, thank you for having me here. I'm honored. I asked four of the students while I was in the music room, Kate, Adrian, Sarah, and Sonia. Nicely done, Sonia, on your reading. What do you like most about North Yarmouth Academy? And boom, the teachers. It's the first thing they said. No hesitation. And it makes sense, doesn't it? I mean, think about Mr. Ian Ramsey. If you tell him that you just did something really cool, he goes, "Of course you did." And if you ask him, "Can I move the piano? We're going to do a jam. Can we move the piano from here to there?" He'll go, "Absolutely." Does he ever say yes? He loves what he does. I hope all of you can find that passion in your lives, that you love what you do. And you know why it's important. There's a lot to be said about the pursuit of happiness. Thomas Jefferson wrote about the pursuit of happiness. But Viktor Frankl, who survived the Holocaust, says you can't really pursue happiness. What you pursue is a life of purpose and meaning. And happiness ensues. It comes around and comes and finds you in the most unexpected, unpredictable ways. Pursue a life of purpose and meaning. Help others. Build your castles in the sky, said Thoreau. Fine. Now put the foundations under them. Go confidently in the direction of your dreams. You've had a privileged beginning, and I salute you parents in the room tonight in this beautiful church. I salute you for the importance you've appended to education for your kids. I salute you. Thank you. Kids, your parents are a lot cooler than you think they are. They grew up listening to the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, Jackson Brown, Prince, the Fleetwood Mac. You'll find out one day. Remember what Mark Twain said? When I was 14 years old, my old man, he didn't know anything. He was so crazy. But by the time I got to be 21, I was amazed how much he had learned in 7 years. Right? So your parents are cool. And okay, so you've had the privileged beginning. That doesn't mean you need to be happy, right? Everybody's fighting a hard battle, some more than others. So be kind, be generous. Give compliments and be sincere in your compliments. If somebody compliments you, pay it forward. Don't give one right back. That's unauthentic. But pay it forward, right? The most beautiful gifts are not the ones that are taken or received, but the ones that are given. The other day in my hometown, a lot of people, we build our homes out of pocket. There's no mortgages and stuff. There's no building codes. Oop, I got my stairway wrong. The rise is longer than the run. I guess I'll never be able to sell it through a bank. It's now listed as a cabin because you built it yourself and you didn't know what you were doing. But man, does it involve creativity. And I like that. Alaska is what America was. And that's exciting. And the kids that came there last summer, I think they tapped into that. Man, we had fun. And it was just as much fun and inspiring for my wife and me as it was for the three of you. So any of you, if you can go out at least once a year, sleep on the ground. Let whales swim through your dreams. Let bears walk up your spine. Leave behind your iPod, iPhone, I, me, mine world, and go out there and sleep on the ground. And I have a friend. She's 20 years old. She's just finishing her sophomore year in Cornell. Erica Gardner. She applied to 11 universities 2 years ago. She got into Duke, Yale, some smaller schools. I think she applied for Colby here in Maine. I can't remember. But she did not get into Cornell. And they had a program there she really wanted to be a part of. I wrote her a letter, and she got in. I wrote a letter to the admissions, and she got in. She was on standby. Her goal, she's 20 years old. She's finishing up her sophomore year in Cornell. Her goal is to bioremediate the oceans. Her goal is to save the oceans. The World Economic Forum predicts that if things don't change by 2050, there'll be more biomass or mass of plastics than fish in the oceans. Something needs to change. The world burns a gigaton of oil every 45 days, a cubic kilometer of oil every 45 days. According to the best science, all we would need to do is burn one-fifth of all the known oil reserves in the world today, oil that has been mapped, discovered, and borrowed against. All we would need to burn is one-fifth of that amount of oil, and we would raise the average global temperatures 2 degrees Celsius above historic levels. At that point, according to the best science, we enter what's called Mr. Toad's Wild Ride. The Pentagon, the military, has hundreds of people working on climate change. They predict that in 20 to 30 years, it's going to cost the U.S. taxpayers $800 billion to $1 trillion to move one Navy base in Virginia because of sea level rise. That's one Navy base. So is there a Rachel Carson or a Steve Jobs among you? Yes, I think so. Go out there and change the world. You don't have to save the world, but go out there and change the world. Make it a better place. Power of the mind, courage of the heart. You have it. Have fun as well. Right? Oh, and save the world and laugh while you're doing it. But I mean, always engage and remember your humanity. Remember your good nature. Remember the teachers you had at North Yarmouth Academy. I was listening to Mr. Ramsey as he was beginning a class the other day, and before they even started to play music, he just jived with the kids. They got laughing, they got talking, they were already warm up, they were already jamming. Right? Take inspiration from these people. They're really smart. They're passionate. They're curious. You've heard about the learning curve? The reason we call it the learning curve is because at some point in your life, it could become the learning line. Some people just give up. They're not learning anymore. They're just settling into the television and letting it wash over them. Right? Challenge yourself. It's fun. right? I was just in Longfellow Books the other day, and I've discovered a book by a fellow named Colin Woodard called American Nations, that we are really composed of about 11 different nations, according to immigration patterns and settlement patterns in the United States. Fascinating book, written by a fellow that lives in Portland, Maine. Pretty cool, huh? Go out and read your fellow writers. So I was on the airplane coming down from Juneau to Seattle, en route to Maine. I was going to Maine to give a commencement speech. I mean, wow, lobsters. Chainsaws. And the fella sitting next to me, maybe he recognized me in my John Lennon glasses, because I wrote most of John Lennon's songs. He just stole them from me. And he gets talking to me, and he's coming on to me pretty heavy about the Old Testament, the New Testament, this Make America Great Again. And I'm going, whoa, okay. And I thought, now, I can respond, because he's coming on pretty strong. And I thought, do you respond in an escalating fashion and end up with hostility? Or do you respond with harmony and try to agree with them and, oh yeah, man, you're so cool. Or do you just respond with civility? How do you respond with civility? I said to him, wow, I see what you're saying. I tapped him on the shoulder. I went, good for you. Does this make you feel better? He went, yeah. I said, good for you. And I said to him, you want to hear a story? And he went, sure. Suddenly his pores opened up. Do you want to hear a story? I mean, how many of you had your grandmother say to you, or your mother or father, come over here, sweetie, sit next to me. Let me read you some bedtime statistics. Right? We all used to learn through stories. So I tell this guy a story about John Muir when he came to Alaska. The point of the spear of the American conservation movement, born in Scotland, raised in Wisconsin, makes his way to California, walks all over the Sierra Nevada, and says to himself, I don't think the Sierra Nevada were formed by catastrophic downfaulting and earthquakes, like the head geologist of the state of California, who shall remain unnamed, believes over and over again. I believe these mountains were shaped by ice. Well, how can ice shape rock? He went to Alaska to see glaciers firsthand. On his second trip to Alaska, they're off in a canoe with four Tlingit Indians and a Presbyterian minister who brings along his little dog, a terrier named Stikeen. And he convinces Muir that Stikeen's going to be the most interesting member of the canoe journey. He can swim like a bear and swim like a seal and run like a bear and climb trees. Well, this dog was very indifferent to human kindness. It did not want to be petted. It did not want to be a pet. So Muir takes off the last day of August, 1880. It's raining. It's cold. It's maybe 40 degrees. He's leaving camp to go up on the Brady Glacier for the day to investigate glacial ice. And along comes this dog. So he walks it back to camp and says, stay, stay. So he takes off again, and here comes this dog who's been indifferent to what they've done all trip long. And now he wants to be with Muir. Up on the ice they go. They spend all day on the ice, crevasses, working their way out into this bewitching maze of crevasses and hummocks of ice. Now they have to get their way back. The light is falling, the rain is turning to snow. They're both mildly hypothermic, and they come upon a crevasse that they cannot find their way across except one sliver bridge of ice. Muir takes his ice axe, notches steps down, notches steps across, just a chasm on both sides, instant death if you fall, notches steps back up to the level of the glacier, turns around and says to the dog, come on. And the dog's whimpering now and howling, going back and forth. He's afraid to make the crossing. Muir pretends to walk away, goes around an ice hummock. The dog still isn't moving. Comes back, come on, fella, come on. If he leaves the dog there, he's going to die for sure. They've got to get back to camp. So Muir gets down on his knees and he says, come on, little fellow. No right way is easy in this world. We must risk our lives in order to save them. I asked Ian Ramsey, how is it that you have the vitality that you do? And he said, I take left turns. I just keep taking left turns. And that's what I've done in my life too, challenging myself. I made a good living as a photographer, leave it behind. It doesn't appeal to me anymore. I'll try this, right? We must risk our lives in order to save them. Golden opportunities mask themselves as insurmountable problems. We're on the cusp of the clean energy revolution. Who among you wants to join? Can you do it? Yes or absolutely? I cannot hear you.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Make it fun. Make it cool. Okay? Go out there and change the world. If you inspire others, as many of you have inspired me, you're off to a great start. Thank you.